بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله الحمد لله بنعمته تتم الصالحات الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله رب العالمين So alhamdulillah, we are starting this semester with a class dealing with the inaugural address of Abu Bakr. So not dealing with the life of Abu Bakr per se, but each week inshallah we'll relate some incidents and aspects of his life and some of his sayings, radiallahu anhu. But the focus over the next several weeks will be examining his inaugural speech, which is one of the great addresses in human history in terms of the depth of wisdom that it contained. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, his name was Abdullah bin Uthman. And he was, so, and of his kunya was Abu Bakr. His laqab, one was Atiq and one was As-Siddiq. And his father, Uthman, his kunya was Abu Quhafa. His mother's name is Qutayla bin Sa'd. He was Qurashi. And he joined with the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at Murrah bin Ka'b bin Lu'ay bin Ghalib bin Fihr bin Malik. So at the Murrah bin Ka'b, that's where the lineage of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu joined with the lineage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was one of the first four people to accept Islam, the first adult male to accept Islam. So you had a young free Arab male, Ali radiallahu anhu, who various accounts list as being 10 or 12 years old at the time of his conversion to Islam, his acceptance of Islam. And you had a free female, Khadija bin Khuwaylid radiallahu anha, was the first to accept the mission, the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you had a servant, Zayd bin Haritha, who was subsequently freed, radiallahu anhu. And you had an adult free man, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So you had a representation, generally speaking, of the society that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came into. So, Abu Bakr was known for his judiciousness. He was known for his deliberateness. He was known for his gentleness, but he was also known for his strength when the situation call for strength and firmness and resolve, as was the case in the immediate aftermath of the passing of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the world. Historians, Western historians, generally neglect the significance of Abu Bakr's khilafah. Usually the focus is on Umar radiallahu anhu as really the great successor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But one should be cognizant of the fact that most of the major accomplishments of Umar radiallahu anhu were set in place by Abu Bakr, and they were set in place in large part by Abu Bakr showing firm resolve in suppressing the rebellions of many of the Central Arabian tribes who come into Islam, and after Islam many of them claimed to be false prophets, such as Musaylimah al-Kadhab, and there were many others. Abu Bakr stabilized that region in a series of military expeditions that have come to be known as Hurub al-Ridda, the wars of apostasy, where these Central Arabian tribes, many of them apostated, left Islam, or distorted it to suit their, some of them affirmed the Salah but refused to pay the Zakat and denied that being a part of Islam. Many of them, as we mentioned, they followed false prophets. So there was an era of chaos, and Abu Bakr was able to decisively suppress those rebellions, and the stability in the heartland of the Arabian Peninsula and in the Hijaz that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu established became the foundation for dispatching the armies both to Persia and to what were the regions controlled by the Byzantine Empire. So those armies were sent by Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, but their victories were during the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu. So Abu Bakr was also instrumental in following the advice of Umar radiallahu anhu in initiating the first gathering of the Quran that was subsequently codified by the project led by Zayd bin Thabit radiallahu anhu majma'in. So Abu Bakr, as we know, he was a major figure, the first Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, as related by Al-Bukhari and other sources, لو اتخذت خليلا لاتخذت أبو بكر أبا بكر خليلا. If I were to take someone as my most intimate and closest and warmest companion, and meaning not only in an emotional sense but also in the sense of as a deputy, then I would take Abu Bakr as my deputy. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr's character is, there's a famous hadith that illustrates the depth and the sincerity of Abu Bakr and the fullness of his Islam. Some people, they're Muslim, they have Islam, and it's hoped that they will have salvation, but their Islam is very shallow. It doesn't run deep. And a depth indicated by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said, they said, deen bit tamanni walakin ma waqara fil qalbi wa saddaqahu al-amal. That religion, here, deen meaning faith rather, is not a wish. They said, deen bit tamanni. It's not a fancy, it's not something you imagine. Walakin, rather, ma waqara fil qalbi, that which takes root in the heart, wa saddaqahu al-amal, and then is testified to by the action. And so Abu Bakr's faith was deep, and the deep roots of his faith gave birth to great actions. A tree that's deeply rooted, a tree whose roots are well irrigated and who's planted in fertile soil brings forth abundant fruit, brings forth multiple branches that provide a wide area of shade. And so this is how Abu Bakr's Islam was, radiallahu anhu. And this is illustrated when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gathered a group of his companions, and he asked them, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, man asbaha minkum al-yawma sa'ima? Qala Abu Bakr ana. He said, who amongst you woke up this morning and dedicated himself or herself to, they've committed themselves to fast the day. Abu Bakr said, I did. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من تبع منكم اليوم جنازة قال أبو بكر أنا. Who amongst you followed a funeral procession today? Abu Bakr said, I did. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من أطعم منكم اليوم مسكينا قال أبو بكر أنا. Who amongst you has fed a poor person today? Abu Bakr said, I did. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم من عاد منكم اليوم مريضا قال أبو بكر أنا. He said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, who amongst you has visited a sick person today? Abu Bakr said, I have. I did. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم, then the Prophet, he said, may the blessings and peace of Almighty Allah be upon him, مَجْتَمَعْنَا فِمْرِئًا إِلَّا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ, that these traits will not be combined in a single person except they will enter paradise. So devotion, he was fasting. respect for the deceased, service to the living, compassion for the sick, radiallahu anhu. All of these characteristics were manifested and combined in Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So his Islam was full. One of the reasons many people go astray today is they overemphasize a particular aspect of Islam and then they neglect other aspects. They overemphasize a particular aspect and neglect other aspects. So there are some people, they're obsessed with what they perceive or describe as their spiritual growth. But they neglect the sick and the poor and the downtrodden. So Abu Bakr was sincere about his spiritual growth. So he was fasting frequently. But that didn't negate his commitment to the oppressed and the downtrodden. Some people are obsessed with the political standing of Muslims and their efforts to rectify the political oppression, the vestiges of colonization and the reality of neo-colonization lead them to engage in atrocities out of their overemphasis on that particular aspect. So Islam has a political aspect, and that's undeniable. But it's an aspect that exists in harmony and in balance with the other aspects of Islam. So some people become so obsessed with the political and they forget that aspect of Islam that provides incredible protection and incredible sanctity to innocent life. And we're all familiar with those aspects of our teaching. So Abu Bakr, his Islam was balanced and it was full, radiallahu anhu. So we'll in the balance of time, and we'll, as I said, each week we'll mention aspects of his life and his character, his personality, but we'll go to his address. So when the various disputes and discussions to settle on who would be the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were done, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had been recognized as the successor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he addressed the people from the minbar of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his masjid, and he said, "Ayyuhan nas, قد وليت عليكم ولست بخيركم فإن أحسنت فعينوني وإن أسأت فقوموني الصدق أمانة والكذب خيانة الضعيف فيكم قوي عندي حتى آخذ له حقا والقوي فيكم ضعيف عندي حتى آخذ منه الحق إن شاء الله ولا يدع أحد منكم الجهاد فإنه لا يدعه قوم إلا ضربهم الله بالذل أتعوني ما أطعت الله ورسوله فإن عصيت الله ورسوله فلا طاعة لي عليكم قوموا إلى صلاتكم رحمكم الله. So he said, رضي الله عنه, to translate what his words, O people, verily I have been placed above you while I'm not the best of you. If I do well, so just to briefly introduce the various subjects we'll talk about, one is humility. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, his first words were an indication of his humility. So he didn't say, you know, I was the best of you. The Prophet ﷺ designated me to lead the prayer during his illness. I was blessed by Allah to accompany him on his hijrah. I was with him in the cave, etc. No, he said, I've been placed over you. أيها الناس قد وليت عليكم ولست بخيركم, and I'm not the best of you. So he claimed no special virtue or status or position for himself, رضي الله عنه. So we're going to look at this aspect of our religion and its implications for us, because they're especially in these days and times. And then he says, فَإِنْ أَحْسَنْتُ, if I do good, فَعَئِنُونِي, then assist me in that good. Help me to be better. And again, this is a sign of humility, and it's a recognition on his part that he doesn't have all the answers, and that even if things are going good, they can be better. So he wasn't satisfied with good. He wanted to be better. And he understood that for any family, organization, institution, you name it, any human collectivity, for it to be better, it has to expand the pool of talent that it draws on. And many of our Muslim countries are failing because the leaders have a very small pool of generally untalented individuals that they trust in, and usually those people are sycophants. There are people who are, we call yes men. You know, things are falling apart. How's it going? Oh, it's going great, boss. You're doing a great job. You're the best thing since sliced bread. Matter of fact, now that I think about it, you're the best thing since air. And things are falling apart. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and you can look at this, the demise of Saddam Hussein, you see, a very small people. And if he didn't trust you, maybe he'd shoot you in the meeting. Yasser Arafat, he goes to Oslo. There was a team of Western intellectuals led by Edward Said who volunteered their services, experts in foreign policy, experts in negotiation and communication, experts in all the relevant fields of endeavor. He rejected that and basically goes against the entire Israeli foreign policy establishment, relying on himself and one or two people who just rubber stamp anything he says. And so look what the Palestinians got out of that, from their leadership. May Allah bless them and give them continued steadfastness. So Abu Bakr is immediately, he's establishing a precedent of expanding. If I do good, so if I do good, applaud me. No, he didn't say that. فَإِنْ أَحْسَنْتُ فَعَيْنُونِي, if I do good, then assist me. Help me to do better. وَإِنْ أَسَدْتُ فَقَوِّمُونِي, and if I err, straighten me up. This is the tone he's setting. And this is very, very, very important for us, because leadership has to set a tone. And that tone has to be an example that encourages participation from others. It has to be a tone that encourages mutual cooperation. It has to be a tone that respects the inputs of others. You can encourage input but not be sincere when the suggestions come, not respect that. Or someone can genuinely show appreciation for assistance that they get, and that resonates throughout the, as we said, the family, the organization, the institution, whatever the relevant case might be. So this is one of the great lessons that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he teaches us, and inshallah we'll elaborate on this next week, this particular aspect. And then he says, radiallahu anhu, as-sidqu amana, that honesty is a trust. Honesty is a sacred trust. We have a trust amongst each other and a trust with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be truthful in all of our affairs. Allah ta'ala mentions in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَنَاتِ إِلَى أَهْلِهَا, that Allah commands you that you deliver the trust to its rightful possessors. And so everyone has a right to the truth. No one deserves to be misled by falsehood. Islam is a reality that dispels and destroys falsehood. So when Allah Ta'ala mentions in the Quran, جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَحْقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا, truth comes, falsehood perishes. That truth is Islam. That truth is Islam. جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَحَقَ الْبَاطِلِ, this is the nature of Islam. It's the truth. It's the truth, and its very nature reposes falsehood, just as it is the nature of light to dispel darkness. Sure, if we turned all the room, these lights off in this room, we'd be in total darkness if we closed the door, so none of the light from the musalla penetrated. As soon as we turn the lights on, the darkness is dispelled. And so humanity has a trust with us. We have a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's placed in us. من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه. So amongst the believers, there are men who are truthful in the covenant they've convened with Allah. And part of that covenant is to convey the truth. To convey the truth to its rightful possessors. And this is the foundation of governance in Islam. Ibn Taymiyyah in his book, As-Siyasat al-Shar'iyya, so the great Damascan, controversial but great scholar Ibn Taymiyyah, he has a book called Divinely Sanctioned Politics, if you will, As-Siyasat al-Shar'iyya. The foundation, the basis of the book is expounding in large part on this verse. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَى أَهْلِهَا وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعْمَّا يَعِدُكُمْ بِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا, that Allah has commanded you, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ, that you deliver the trust to its rightful possessors. وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ, and if you rule or judge between people, and تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ, that you do so with justice. What an excellent thing Allah commands you with, and Allah is all-seeing, all-hearing, all-seeing. So, we have a trust, and we can't live our lives as if we're oblivious and totally unaware of the responsibility that we have as believers. كُلُّكُمْ مَسْعُولٌ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْعُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَةٍ, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْعُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَةٍ, all of you are stewards, and each of you will be asked concerning their wards. This is a religion of responsibility. كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْعُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَةٍ, all of you, كُلُّكُمْ, And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he goes on to say, al-rajulu, al-imra'a, al-abdu, everyone has a responsibility. Allahumma salli ala rasulillah. Ibn Hajj al-Asqalani in Fath al-Bari, when he comments on this particular hadith, kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun an ra'iyati, he says that those who have no wards, those who have no familial, contractual, or other people under who are they're responsible to, then they're responsible for their limbs. They're responsible for their limbs. And so to just emphasize, no one escapes a position or role of responsibility in this religion. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is emphasizing that. And all of us are responsible for the truth. All of us, collectively. وَالْكَذِبُ خِيَانَةً. Truthfulness, الصِّدْقُ أَمَانَةً, is a sacred trust. And lying is treachery. Lying is treachery. When we lie to someone, we're behaving treacherously with them. We're betraying them. We're betraying the trust that we owe to them. And the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, a believer can be many things, but he cannot be a liar. She cannot be a liar. This is something that steals our faith away. Why? Because we come into Islam on the basis of a truthful profession of faith. That's the foundation of our belief. And our pursuit of truth follows from that. If we're lying, it doesn't count, right? You take shahada and you're not sincere, it doesn't count. You take shahada, you're not sincere because someone's forcing you. Someone's physically threatening you. It doesn't count. It has to be free, and there has to be a sincere commitment to the truth. There has to be a sincere belief that what I profess belief in, is the truth. And everything proceeds from that. So, as-sidqu aman wal-kadibu khiyana. الضعيف فيكم قوي عندي حتى أخذ له حقه. The one who is weak with you is strong with me until I take, secure for him the right that is owed to him. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says that this rule that I'm establishing it for the benefit of the weak in society, to ensure that they are protected by the society, that their rights are secured by the leadership rather. Look at our political system. It's for the service of the wealthy. And because it's for the service of the wealthy, poor people are trampled on. Poor people, our needs are neglected. And in ways that are so deep, we're just in Teaneck, New Jersey. It's a very wealthy neighborhood. They pay no taxes. They found every possible loophole in the tax code to pay no taxes and to defund the schools and put the money where? In the probably one of the most militarized police forces in this country. So the tax dollars that do exist, the rich people pay as little tax as possible. The tax money, but they control the city council. The tax money that's available doesn't go to the benefit of the poor kids in public schools. Defund music. They don't need music. Defund many of the athletic programs. They don't need athletic programs. Take the money and spend it on the police. Buy them armored vehicles. Buy them machine guns. Buy them all of these things that military forces use. They're not peace officers. That's what a policeman is known as, a peace officer. Well, it's the service for the rich. All of these bombings and pumping weapons, into these countries. Who does it serve? It serves the wealthy. Who do what? Control the political system, direct the tax dollars for these war industries, create these bogus wars. Yemen is a bogus war. We have to stop Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. A friend of mine was doing business there. I said, you know, isn't your business affected by Al-Qaeda? He said, there's a handful of people out in the desert. They're not bothering anybody. And you look at the struggles there and the parties. But why are all these bombings? Why are these bombings necessary? It hasn't altered the strategic balance of forces. It's blown up schools, hospitals, bazaars, and the little bit of infrastructure that does exist in Yemen. And there are other forces at work, but this bombing, bomb supplied, plane supplied by the American taxpayer, what does it do? It keeps these armed industries pumping out bombs. You know, President Obama was recently in Laos. Laos, a country probably that has less people population-wise than this Bay Area. We had to cut off the Ho Chi Minh Trail that was running through Laos and sending soldiers and supplies to South Vietnam to fight our army. What were we doing there in the first place? Another question. So we dumped 280 million tons of bombs, 280 million tons of bombs on Laos. So, and it never stopped the Ho Chi Minh Trail. What did it do? It kept the bomb factories going. Serving the rich, disadvantaging the poor. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he says, I'm establishing a political authority that serves the poor. Al-da'ifu fikum qawiyun indi hatta akhudha lahu haqqa. And I'm going to stand up to the rich. وَالْقَوِيُّ فِيكُمْ ضَعِيفٌ عِنْدِي حَتَّى أَخُذَ مِنْهُ الْحَقِّ إِنْشَاءَ. And the strong amongst you is weak with me until I take from him the right that he owes to others, if Allah so wills. So this is the foundation of Islam: humility, honesty, transparency, service to the poor. Radiallahu anhu. And then he says, وَلَا يَدْعَ أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمُ الْجِهَادَ. Don't let any one of you leave off struggling. And we have to know what our struggle is. But all of us have to struggle. This is a religion of struggle. This is a religion of struggle. This is, and when we stop struggling, we start bickering with each other. So in the Sahaba, they started bickering with each other. And so what did the Prophet do? And the Aus and Khazraj, they're remembering their old feud, and you have people stoking, trying to bring those old flames that are flickering embers, bring them back to life and burst into full flame. What does he do? We're going to Tabuk. We're marching across the hottest part of this Arabian desert in the height of the summer. We're mobilizing. We're going to struggle. Because this is a religion of struggle. And when we stop struggling, we start bickering. We start magnifying petty things into big things. Because we leave off the big things that you have to struggle and exert effort to achieve. So we as a community, we have to be a community of struggle. And saying that, I'm not talking about armed struggle. That's not our struggle. When we elaborate on this part of his address, we'll get into all the relevant details here. But we have to struggle. We have to struggle in the context of our homes. Some of us, we think that marriage, child rearing, all this stuff is going to be easy. It doesn't take a struggle. It's like we're just on the good ship Lollipop, and then when the good ship Lollipop hits the iceberg, we're ready to just abandon, give up. Scuttle the marriage. Get rid of the children. you know, send them off to some juvenile center. I can't stand these brats anymore. Well, they're just your parents' revenge. We have to struggle in our society. We get a little bit people looking at us funny and making snide remarks and saying nasty things, and we think it's the end of the world. We have it so hard now. We don't have it hard, we have it great. They have it hard in Yemen. Being bombed and all sorts of groups and armed forces, you don't know who you can trust. A blockade, you can't get food in. People have no food. They have it hard in Yemen. They have it hard in Syria. They have it hard in Halab right now, in Aleppo. Being bombed. Ban Ki-moon said today, Aleppo is like a slaughter. It's worse than a slaughterhouse. Human beings being massacred and butchered in some of the most horrific ways. Barrel bombs. Barrels filled with high explosive and laced with nails and shrapnel and chlorine gas and then dropped on civilian populations, the Russian bunker busters, bombs that leave a crater 7 meters deep and 20 meters wide, shattering walls 75 meters away. They have it hard. We don't have it hard. And you'll find within that, people who are still patient, who are still hopeful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are still holding on to their deen. Now, some of our young people, they go to a science or philosophy class and they're ready to leave Islam. No struggle to hold on. No effort to go, you know, I'm going to go read up on this. I'm amazed. I'm not picking on you young people. I'm just saying. It amazes me. I'm absolutely flabbergasted, dumbfounded, and otherwise perplexed. When I talk to a young person, I don't know if I'm a believer. I left Islam. Why did you leave Islam? Because, my philosophy professor presented an argument that there's no God. I said, well, did you bother to read the counter-argument? No. Did you read any of the theological defenses of God? Did you read the ontological argument for God? Did you read the philosophical argument for God? Did you read the metaphysical argument, proof for God's existence? No, no, no. Oh, you read Richard Dawkins, you read The God Delusion. Did you read David Berlinsky's The Devil's Delusion, Atheism and His Scientific Pretensions? No. Oh, you read Stephen Hawking. Did you read John Lennox's devastating rebuttal and critique of Stephen Hawking? No. So your faith meant that much to you that you gave it up? You didn't even bother to investigate the argument that put you out of Islam? Ajib, that's amazing. That the faith was so cheap, it wasn't even worth fighting for. And so so people like that just become pathetic marginal notes in someone else's story. And so what did he say? فَلَا يَدَعَ أَحَدٌ مِنْكُمُ الْجِهَادَ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَدَعُهُ قَوْمٌ إِلَّا دَرَبَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِالذُّلِّ. Because no one is struggling except that Allah afflicts them with humiliation. So because we don't struggle, because we don't stand up and defend what's rightfully ours, and I'm talking about defend it with our words, defend it with our ideas, with our thoughts, we become humiliated. We become humiliated. أَتِرُونِي مَا أَطَعْتُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Obey me as long as I obey Allah and His Messenger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, in other words, he's saying, I have no inherent right to rule you. My right to rule you is a function of my obeying Allah and His Messenger. فَإِنْ أَصَيْتُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَلَا تَعَتَ لِي عَلَيْكُمْ. If I disobey Allah and His Messenger, then you have no right to obey me. SubhanAllah, can you imagine some of our modern leaders saying that? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. You have no right to obey me. Because I have no inherent right to be obeyed. My right to be obeyed is a function of my obedience to Allah and His Messenger. That's where it stops, that's where it ends. So again, this is amongst other things, this is a statement of humility. I'm just like the rest of you guys in terms of the right that I have over you. And any right that I do have is only a function of my obeying Allah and His Messenger. And if I disobey Allah and His Messenger, you owe me no obedience. You owe me no obedience. This is true in a marriage. When the hadith, فَإِنَّهُ لَتَعْتِي لِمَخْلُوكٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةُ الْخَالِقِ. There's no obeying the creation if it involves disobeying the Creator. One of the things Ibn Hajar talks about, and Fath al-Bari about this, he says that, Allahumma salli Rasulillah, he brings the example of a wife obeying her husband. And he says, if he's commanding her with something that involves rebellion against Allah and His Messenger, she has no right to obey him. So this is across the board. This is across the board. So again, why? Because as we said, we're trying to uphold the religion of God in the world. What if Muslims just capitulate? Then it's over. It's over. What if all the sisters just take hijab off? That's it. There's no other community now that has hijab. The Christians had hijab, it's gone. Look at the old paintings, they had the bonnets on and scarves. Gone. The Jews had hijab, gone. Maybe some other peoples, and it's gone. The Muslims let it go, it's gone. And what Sid Abdul Hakim Murad calls the monoculture wins. The monoculture wins. Everyone just be like Hollywood wants you to be. Dress like Hollywood, act like Hollywood, you know, frivolous and Hollywood-like. Just wave your hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care. Think like Hollywood wants you to think. And where is the commitment traditional societies that existed before Hollywood? When what human beings were was a sum total of the collective wisdom of their ancestors as the foundation for their engaging their time and their place. Hollywood has no commitment to the collective wisdom of our ancestors. So, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is laying down a foundation for a functional society. And then finally he says, "Kumu ila salatikum rahimukumullah." That at the end of the day, after all has been said and done, it comes down to each and every one of us standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this world, what do we do in salah? We stand before Allah ta'ala. This is a reminder of the time we will stand before Allah ta'ala in the next world. And we have to be reminded, because one of the greatest realities leading to sin and rebellion is forgetting that we will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. The one who fears the time they will stand before their Lord. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ. And because they fear the time they will stand before their Lord, they deny their soul the things it might whimsically incline towards. وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. This is the exact opposite. This is the exact opposite of what this liberal environment, liberal in the sense of licentious, not in the sense of liberal arts, which liberate the human being to realize the importance of responsibility before his or her Lord. I have to add that caveat. It tells us the opposite. It says, don't do anything to control your desires. And no one has a right to encourage you or to tell you to control your desires. So the Quran is telling us, control your desires, you go to heaven. وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. This society is telling, surrender to your desires. And look at the confusion it creates. Look at the confusion it creates. Now our sisters, they might be in a public bathroom and some guy bigger than me walks in. And he says, you know, I think I'm a girl, a female. And the society says, well, if that's what you want to be, that's what you are, going to the girl's bathroom. It's massive confusion. I'm not trying to hate on anyone, I'm just making a point. How does that happen? It happens when a society says, don't control your desires. If you want to be a female and you were biologically born a male, then be a female, and vice versa. No, we believe in a different philosophy of life. So accept it, you're different. And our Prophet ﷺ, he prophesied that a time would come when you would be different. بَدَأَ الْإِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا وَسَيَعُودُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَأَ فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. Islam started as something strange and it will return to being strange as it began. Paradise. Congratulations to the strangers. Weirdos. So that's a summary of the expression. So next, the next several week, we'll take a deep dive into each part, inshallah ta'ala. May Allah give everyone tawfiq, taysir, wal faraj, wal nasal Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lana wa lakum wa lil muslimina jami'an, al faraj, wal taysir, wal takhfif, wa nasal Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أن يوفقنا الله جميعا إلى ما هو يحبه ويرضى إنه على كل شيء قدير وبالحمد جدير وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. So if anyone has a few brief questions, so this class is right now from immediately after Maghrib until 8 o'clock, and soon Maghrib, even next week I think will be before 7 o'clock. So it's generally be 7 to 8, inshallah. I want to remind everybody to come to Chandni restaurant this Saturday at 4 p.m. You all know where Sunday, rather. Almost messed up. UPS dinner. So United Productions, Michael Wolf and their team, they have done so many wonderful media projects to help familiarize people in this country with Islam by having their annual benefit dinner Sunday, 4 p.m. at Chandni Restaurant. Myself and many others will be there as their guests. And we invite you all to be there. And I think there's some flyers out front. And for more information, you can go to their website, Unity Productions. And this particular program will be focused on their latest film, The Sultan and the Saint, which has been inspired by the meeting of Ahmed Kulkan and Egypt, the great Mamluk Sultan, Ahmed Kulkan, and Saint Francis, the patron saint of the poor, who our current Pope has chosen to name himself after. So this is a very famous encounter with Francis during the Crusades. He went to Cairo and embraced the Muslims and learned from the ulama there, was very humble and respectful. And so that encounter and that experience is the basis of Unity Productions' latest film, The Sultan and the Saint. So let's go and show them some love and some support. Sunday, Chandi Restaurant. Allah barik fikum. Yes.
Wa alaikum
salam wa rahmatullah.
Can you talk about some context as to how soon after he was appointed Khalifa that he gave the speech and who he gave it to, how big was the crowd, how they get the crowd, and how do we know the authenticity of the speech?
The speech is related in many sources. And then come down to us, it was immediately after most of the people had given their bayah, virtually everyone. And it's well known Imam Ali delayed giving his bayah, but subsequently he did. So it was as soon as the various cases were made, and then after the people publicly gave their bayah, Abu Bakr gave the speech, and it's assumed that a very large percentage of the believers were there, because the uncertainty, people were looking for direction. And so this was a statement on the part of Abu Bakr that endeavored to give the people direction and guidance and to assure them that the essence of the Prophet's mission, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would continue through his reign. So, inshallah, we could bring specific citations in terms of narration, etc. next week, inshallah. Yes, sir. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you so much for the lesson. I had a quick question on your translation of the ayah. I was curious where you got the effect, but you said because of the fear.
No, as وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ, the one who fears the time they will stand before the Lord. This is the dominant interpretation. Some interpret it, they fear the standing of their Lord. But most say, including Jalalain, when they will stand before the Lord. وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى, and they deny their soul those things that it whimsically inclines towards. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى, and then paradise will be their destination, final destination. So what is your question in that context?
When you were speaking, you said because of their fear of standing in front of their Lord, they deny.
Okay.
But
maybe in the heat of battle,
okay,
I misspoke. But this is the official, unofficial translation that I just related, inshallah. Sisters, anything before we run off? No? Alright, so inshallah we see everyone next week. May you have a blessed week. May you be too blessed to be stressed. May in the struggle of ideas and character, you always prove to be the best. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.